We look at the universe, right? And let's say we look at opposite points on the sky. And those opposite points have never communicated with each other, obviously, because the light from both of them is only reaching us now. So they never had a chance to communicate. And yet they're at exactly the same temperature. Okay? How amazing is that? Now, one explanation for this fact that the universe is astonishingly
uniform
in all directions, right? Homogeneous and isotropic. The one explanation for that is there was a period of inflation in which the universe was actually a very small object in which everything was communicating. So it somehow thermalized. And then it was blown up into this gargantuan universe we see around us today. And they correlated because once upon a time, they knew about each other. And they did communicate with each other before the Big Bang, if you like. But during the inflating epoch, they did communicate with each other. Now, as you know, I'm not a believer in that picture. That's a very classical picture, actually. And it's extremely ad hoc because you postulate a form of matter, an initial condition, which is this kind of exponential expansion before the Big Bang, in order to explain what we see. I don't think that's necessary at all. You see, I think the error that's being made is the classic one, which is that correlation does not imply causation. Right? We see the temperatures correlated on two sides of the sky. It doesn't mean that one side caused the other one. It just means they're correlated.
So they want to preserve locality, and that's why they came up with inflation?
They want to preserve, well, I would say they were stuck on classicality, and a classical notion of causality, right, which quantum mechanics violates. They were stuck on that,
right,
and they wanted to preserve locality. So let me phrase the question another way, because there's a sort of very basic way of seeing this. Imagine we're doing statistical mechanics. We're trying to describe the behavior and of gas in a room. So it's a perfectly rectangular room, no doors or windows. We throw a bunch of molecules into it. There are a certain number of molecules, and they have a certain total energy. Kinetic energy. They're just flying around and bouncing off the walls. So question is, what's a typical state, right, for molecules of gas in a box or a room? And many people would say, oh, you need ergodicity. You need the dynamics. You know, what happens is these particles, even if you put them all in a corner, they will spread themselves out, so that the typical state will be quite uniform, homogeneous and isotropic, just like the universe. But that takes time, and it requires them to explore essentially all the possible configurations to find the most probable ones. Okay. This argument, I believe, is absolutely wrong, okay, in principle. If you give me a box full of molecules with certain total energy, what you can do, if somebody says, what's the typical state of the molecules in the box? You know the energy, you know the number of molecules. What do? Well, you want to count the states. You want to count all the possible states. So what do? You quantize the molecules. A quantized particle in a box has a certain number of states. And if they're n particles, I know exactly what all the states are. I find those states which are consistent with the given total energy, and they basically live on a shell in the space of quantum numbers, and I pick one at random. Okay. That's a typical state. You can't get a better defined notion of typicality than that. That is 100% kosher, because I quantized everything, so everything's specified by integers. I'm not biasing the calculation in any way. I'm only telling you the macroscopic variables, the energy and the number of particles, and you pick at random. And what you'll find is the typical state is homogeneous and isotropic. You know, that's the explanation. You don't need ergodicity or dynamics to explain correlations. correlations are inevitable when you have a well-defined ensemble, probability ensemble. So the same for the universe. Are we really surprised that one side of the universe is the same temperature as the other? If we know the dynamics, and if we can show that when we count states, the typical state has the two sides at the same temperature.
Right.
Now, Latham Boyle and I, have published papers showing exactly that, that we assume Einstein's theory of gravity, the path integral for gravity, and then we generalized Hawking's calculation of the entropy of a black hole using exact solutions in cosmology.
By the way, you should know that I spoke to Latham Boyle here. The link is on screen and in the description. It was a presentation on the math of the CPT symmetric universe.
And we discovered that the maximum entropy configuration for a cosmology is homogeneous, isotropic, spatially flat, which our universe appears to be, and has a small positive cosmological constant. It fits with all the observations. So you don't need anything else. You just need to count. You don't need a sort of ad hoc dynamics, which inflationary theorists would have you believe in a prior epoch prior to the standard. But you don't need any of that. You just need the known laws of physics. And indeed, our whole point is, in all our work on cosmology and black holes, that the laws we already know, quantum mechanics, general relativity, and the standard model of particle physics, are capable of explaining everything we see. Okay? We don't need to keep inventing new particles, new dimensions, multiverses. You know, I think the whole field sort of went haywire. And the spirit of our work is to return to simplicity and foundational principles. And again, we've discovered that certain things have been overlooked, which, you know, to us anyway, appear to be much simpler explanations for, you know, everything we see. So I hope, we can't be sure our ideas are right. I mean, they seem to be converging with the data.
Mm-hmm.
One prediction we made is that the lightest neutrino is massless. And just a few weeks ago, the DESI galaxy survey has now put very tight upper limits on the mass of the lightest neutrino, and it's consistent with exactly what we predicted. And that was a consequence of our explanation of the dark matter. So, you know, it takes us a bit further afield, but basically we are finding that it is possible to explain all observed phenomena in the universe using these basic principles of CPT symmetry and the standard model. And very little else.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's talk about some cosmological data. So,
sure.
While we're on this subject. So DESI, a few months ago, I believe they indicated that dark energy can be dynamical.
Ah, good. This was the same series of papers. It was just last month. This is the subject of a bet I have with a colleague of mine here. So what DESI has done, I mean, it's an absolutely fantastic survey of galaxies and galaxy redshifts. And they have tried to infer the expansion history of the universe, how rapidly it was expanding as we look back in time.
And just as an aside,
sure.
For those who want to know more about your Big Bang is a mirror theory and,
yes,
and your whole
yes.
theory of everything, in a sense, you and I, Neil, had a conversation that went quite in-depth and it also went viral. And if people want to learn more about the recent DESI results, I'll put a link to an Economist article on screen where they explained it as well, but you're about to explain it, so please.
Super. Yeah, so the DESI result and there have been a number of results along these lines is what's pointing to a tension, people usually refer it to as a tension, between the, let's say, standard model of cosmology, which is very minimal and very predictive, and the data. So one of these tensions is called the Hubble tension. that the most basic parameter in cosmology, the expansion rate of the universe, is called the Hubble constant, and different ways of measuring it give slightly different results. Not hugely different. I mean, they differ by about 10%. But nevertheless, this seems to be inconsistent with their estimated error bars. So the Hubble tension has existed for a while. It continues to exist. The new DESI measurements have not shed any light on that. But the DESI experiment discovered another tension, which is that in the standard model, the cosmological constant is inserted as a free parameter. And this cosmological constant is a sort of very, very old theoretical construct. It was invented by Einstein, I think, in 1917, when he wrote down his first model for the universe. The reason he invented it was it is the simplest conceivable form of matter. A cosmological constant is absolutely smooth in space, absolutely unchanged in time, unchanging in time. And it's also what we call Lorentz invariant. Namely, if you move through space, this cosmological constant won't change at all. So it's a strange form of energy, which you can think of as just sort of almost like an ether. It's just a uniform, invariant, unchanging thing. And Einstein realized that this type of energy or matter would be gravitationally repulsive, that it pushes space to expand. Whereas other forms of matter, like the stuff we're made of, or dark matter, or radiation, causes space to contract. And so Einstein balanced the cosmological constant's repulsion against the attraction of ordinary matter to make a static universe. So to him, he didn't know about the expansion of the universe. So he thought he had to explain why is the universe, you know, able to exist when gravity is trying to cause it to collapse. So he used the repulsive gravity of the cosmological constant to hold up the universe. Sadly, he didn't realize that this balance was unstable. And so even in this delicately balanced universe, either you would collapse one way or you would expand to infinity. And so his solution didn't really work. Nevertheless, we have recently discovered, this was in the 90s, that this cosmological constant is about 70% of all the energy in the universe. It's been called the biggest problem in physics. Why does even empty space have this energy, the cosmological constant, which, as I say, is unchanging and absolutely uniform? Where did it come from? Why is there a cosmological constant? The standard model includes this. And because it's included, it's able to fit a huge range of data. So it's one parameter, but it explains, you know, hundreds of thousands of observations. So it's a pretty good model. Now, DESI comes along and they said our data doesn't quite fit the standard model. In the standard model, this cosmological constant is causing a universe to accelerate its expansion, but they find that the acceleration is not exactly as predicted by a cosmological constant. It takes a very weird form. So it was accelerating more in the past, and then apparently in recent epochs, that additional acceleration is going away. Okay, so it's not a model anybody dreamed up. It's not a theory anybody dreamed up. They're finding their data fits, and all they do is a fit. They don't have a theory. So they do a fit to it, and they find that they can fit it by assuming that the cosmological constant, which is one number, is replaced by two numbers, one of which is the value now of the cosmological constant, and the other, if you like, is the sort of rate of change in the past. as we look to the past of this cosmology. So they fit, they've got a two-parameter model, and they say it fits better.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.